Varun and Shashank from Enkidu. Hi guys.
Hey.
So what are we going to talk about today?
So
blockchain?
Today, blockchain, yes.
And why it's relevant, Varun?
I think that's the topic.
I'll tell you what. Okay, for those of you whose minds have been blocked by this concept called blockchain, these guys are going to unravel for you what the mystery behind blockchain is, and they're going to differentiate between blockchain, Bitcoin, Ethereum, whatnot,
yes.
And they'll tell you why their business is relevant. Right? Let's start with you, Varun, now. Firstly, what does Enkidu do?
Mm-hmm.
And why did you pick blockchain as the business that will bring you money in the future?
Got it. So I think I'll give you a little bit of background on this. We're used to starting and running a lot of companies, right? We do it in multiple jurisdictions.
Okay.
And it's the same process all over again.
Mm-hmm.
You find a jurisdiction you want to register this in. Then you register it, then you get an auditor, then you get the legal process, or you need to do your finance auditing at the end of the year. And all that is expensive, right? In India, it takes, you pay your share capital of 1 lakh,
correct,
and then so on and so forth, and by the end of the year, you burn 5 lakhs. And that's
right.
In India, right? And in the United States, that goes up to $5,000 a
mm-hmm.
year. And we were doing it so many times because you've
set up how many businesses?
So we've, what,
seven.
So seven now. But it was the same process, right? And the way we do business is we partner with people across the world, right?
Okay.
So in some cases we're a really good tech team.
Mm-hmm.
In some cases we're a really good sales and marketing team.
Okay.
So we reach out to people across the world and
mm-hmm.
we say, you know what, you're really good at sales. We'll build your product that you can sell.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they're really good at developing software, we go to them and we tell them, look, we've got an Indian network. We've
mm-hmm.
got a network in the United States that we can sell software to. Would you like to come here and, you know, give us that technology so we'll sell it for you? So we do JVs, right?
Okay.
I mean, that was our bread and butter. And when we were doing all of these JVs, eventually it became clear that we were doing the same process too many times,
mm-hmm.
right? And
mm-hmm.
we just needed to simplify that process, right? And that got us thinking, what exactly is a company, right? And you can actually break it down. A company is a way where, say, three of us wanted to partner together.
Mm-hmm.
You have some percentage of the company.
Yes.
I have some percentage.
Correct.
And he has some percentage.
Mm-hmm.
When somebody pays us money,
mm-hmm.
say somebody gives us 100 rupees for something
right.
we're selling them. Say we're
right.
selling shirts.
Yes.
That 100 rupees gets split between you, me, and Shashank
correct.
In some ratio that we decide.
Right.
Maybe you're putting in all the effort, so you get like 60%.
Yeah.
Me and Shashank,
right.
you know, we have 20%.
Okay.
And that simple process, of course, there are a lot of layers to this process.
Right,
and the minute you enter this industry, you'll understand, oh, the share capital is this, that, the dividends.
Okay.
But at its core, this is what it is.
Hmm.
And we said, can we take the process of making a company and take it to its roots, that is this, and then build each layer one on top of the other?
Okay.
The only funda being, can we do it on the blockchain?
Okay.
Right? And what does the main advantage that blockchain gives us? We can bring this cost from $5,000 a year or, you know, your 2 or 3 lakhs a year to zero.
Okay.
Right? And all we take in return is a 0.5% transaction fee.
Mm-hmm.
So here's a concept. It is a slightly complicated concept,
mm-hmm.
but this is as simple as it gets. A payment gateway is there on your website. You're
right.
selling t-shirts. The minute a payment hits the payment gateway,
mm-hmm.
that payment gets split between you,
yes.
me, and Shashank.
Okay.
And all of that happens on the blockchain. All
right.
Right? We offer this payment gateway
mm-hmm.
and this splitter and any of the rules that you'd need to run a company.
Okay.
Say we want to add somebody new. How do we do that in the offline world, right? It's a very simple process to anybody who's run a company. You pick up a piece of paper,
mm-hmm.
you say board resolution,
mm-hmm.
I want to add this new person, add this share
holding.
On our system, you can just press a button that says add new person.
Okay.
You click that button, you say, okay, I want 20%.
Mm-hmm.
And then a voting panel opens up
mm-hmm.
and three of us vote.
All right.
And depending on our...
So only when the three of us agree
yeah.
will a third, fourth person
yes.
be added.
Not the three of us agree, but
mm.
a majority of
majority.
The three of us.
Majority. That's the two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Two of us. So quickly, okay, I got what you do. That's how the company was formed
yes.
also.
Yeah.
But tell them what blockchain is. Come on, quickly. Let's talk about blockchain first. Then let's separate that with Bitcoin. Tell them what Bitcoin is.
Yeah.
And then talk about ICO. Then
okay.
talk about Ethereum. I'll leave it to both of you. Who wants to start? Let's start with blockchain.
A blockchain. Yeah, so the thing, there's a lot of confusion in the cryptocurrency world that Bitcoin equals blockchain, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that's not exactly true. So the thing is, Bitcoin is a currency that works on top of a blockchain.
Correct.
Right? Blockchain is the underlying technology of Bitcoin.
Right.
right? And what is blockchain? Blockchain is, I'll give it in a simple example, right? So we have databases.
Right.
And in today's date, the database is held by what, private companies.
Correct.
And public companies,
very
right?
True.
But the information inside the database is private,
right?
And can be manipulated.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, today, if you look at banks or you look at different kind
mm-hmm.
of systems,
mm-hmm.
institutions, they try to manipulate these prices or invoices and backdate
yeah.
it and manipulate
right.
the system completely.
Mm-hmm.
But on a blockchain, what blockchain does is it puts all these transactions which are on the database, okay, on a public server where
okay.
everyone all over the world can see it,
mm-hmm.
right? And it is impossible to go back and manipulate a pre-existing transaction.
Okay.
So what blockchain does is, one, it makes everything transparent.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very easy for people to track each other's transactions. So there's complete transparency in the whole market.
Okay.
And two, it reduces the risk of, you know, being hacked or, you know, being in a centralized server.
Okay. I have a question quickly.
Yeah.
If the three of us agree to manipulate the chain,
yeah.
can it be manipulated?
No. So
why do you say?
I'll tell you why. So each transaction mm. gets attached to the next block,
right.
and the next block gets attached to another block.
Okay.
Right? You cannot go back and manipulate this block.
The three of us together can't.
We
if
can't.
You made
Only,
the blockchain,
yeah.
you could.
If you made the blockchain and you own more than 51% of the computing power,
mm.
you can actually break the blockchain or, you know, fork it into another thing, right?
Mm.
But it is almost next to impossible. If you're talking about Bitcoin, it is almost next to impossible
mm.
that someone can own 51% of the world's computing power that's actually going into the Bitcoin.
Wait, let me get this right to the audience. The three of us are transacting, but
yes.
somebody else verifies a transaction.
Yes.
Is it
yes.
true?
So I'll explain in very, very simple
okay.
terms, right? Everybody, it's like a Google Sheets. I think
okay.
everyone's used Google
right,
Docs. Right,
exactly.
So you have a Google
Remember,
Docs.
Remember, it's like a Google Sheets. He's going to explain it to you. Go on.
Google Docs, very simple.
Right.
You have rows,
mm.
and in each row, you have transactions.
Correct.
Let's say there are only three people in the system,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And we've made the blockchain.
Right.
So each of our computers
mm-hmm.
will have one copy of that Google Sheets.
I
and
agree.
Every time a change is made on your computer,
mm-hmm.
same change is made on my computer,
mm-hmm.
same with Shashank.
Okay.
So let's put the first row of the computer
mm-hmm.
to say you
mm-hmm.
have sent me five of something.
Let's say I'm the government. Let's take the government example.
Yeah,
sure. I give you a tender.
Sure.
And he is the contractor.
Sure.
Right? Between the three of us, how does it work?
Sure. So you've given me 5
Correct.
Rupees. Suppose it says 5 rupees.
Yes.
Now, unlike a regular bank transfer where 5 rupees goes from my account and goes here.
Yes. I use the bank to transfer to you.
Yes.
Yes.
Here,
right.
the transactions are just logged. So
okay.
one after the other. So the wallet balances
mm.
of mine, yours and Shashank's are calculated wherever the current blockchain
mm.
is.
Okay.
Right? So first transaction goes you to Varun,
mm.
5 rupees.
All right.
Right. The next transaction is Varun to Shashank, 3
right.
rupees. And all
right.
of this is on the blockchain.
Right.
Now assume for a moment,
mm.
I speak to Shashank and I say, listen, let's edit the second thing and let's change it from 5 to 7. Let's
right.
make it seem like I've sent you more money.
Correct.
Right. If we own 51% of the blockchain,
mm-hmm.
in this case we do,
mm-hmm.
then we can manipulate the system.
All right.
But of course, it's not very easy to do. You'll have, it's an encrypted system and
mm-hmm.
going back block
mm-hmm.
to blocks is difficult. So you'll have to actually
break. So you're saying you as a contractor actually own the system, this computing power there?
In this particular
case,
because only three
of us.
But if I'm the government trying to float a tender in the blockchain world, there will be a third party verifying the transaction all the time?
Not necessarily. All of us are verifying the transactions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Every single computer
mm-hmm.
has a log of every new transaction
okay.
that happens.
Okay.
So if one bad actor tries to change the transaction,
Everyone
first, knows. All of the transactions, there'll be a verifier.
Mm.
It'll be like, okay, this guy has put a wrong transaction here, let's kick him out of the network.
But if you just said you own 51% of the compute power,
yeah.
you can
yeah.
manipulate.
Yes,
how
yes.
do we? How does the government control this? How does any party control
You get
this?
Enough players involved.
Yeah, so
okay.
I'll tell you how it works in today's
okay.
date, right? When you talk about the Bitcoin and how the blockchain is, I mean, it works there is, there are a lot of miners who actually verify these transactions.
Agreed.
Right? But these miners are spread across the world
mm.
and there are millions and millions of miners together.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to manipulate the
right.
Bitcoin system, right, you need to convince 51% of the world's miners to come together and pool in the computing power to break the
okay.
blockchain.
Okay.
Which is, that's why it's next to impossible because
okay.
by the time you do that, I mean, the mathematical problem keeps increasing and then you need supercomputers to come and solve it. So when the founder of Bitcoin actually made this, right, which no one knows still.
Mm-hmm.
So when he made this, he thought about all these situations when
mm-hmm.
he started this. And that is why till date, it's very, 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 almost next to impossible to actually break the
so
blockchain.
So staying on this track itself, what
mm-hmm.
stops parties,
mm-hmm.
I mean like companies,
yeah.
governments, to get on the blockchain? Is it because A, they are scared that there is a third party unknown to them verifying these transactions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Or can they say that they can get onto a system where it's their own blockchain, the three parties or four parties or multi-parties can work together, But like you said, if somebody owns 51% of the compute power, they can manipulate.
Yes.
So what are the challenges of these companies or governments coming to blockchain today?
So think about it this way, right? Like, when you have a monarchy,
mm-hmm.
when you have a king who's making decisions, nobody can question
yeah,
the decision. He's
yeah,
the verifier.
Yeah.
He's
correct.
Judge.
He's the end all, be all, everything.
Correct. What is so special about our system? We're a democracy, right?
Mm.
Everybody gets one vote.
Mm. At least they're made to think so.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, you can manipulate the votes, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
But there's still enough factors.
Mm. Mm.
So in this three-man system,
mm.
I just need to convince Shashank to vote against you.
Right.
Or to vote for me.
Right.
Right? And then it's over.
Yeah.
Right? It's easy to do with the three
right.
players. But if there are 1 million players, for me to get all of them, half of them to vote for one party, is still easier.
Mm.
But to get all 1 million players,
mm.
or one, you know, the billions of population that India has, to get all of them to change a particular transaction from Shashank sent this one 5 rupees to 7 rupees is next to impossible.
Yeah, that is. So that's exactly what I'm saying. Is that the fundamental challenge why people
yes.
don't want to get into?
Yes, it's a psychology.
Mm.
That's one of the challenges. The second challenge is you're going to become transparent, right?
Mm.
So if you talk about banks or, you know, political parties and
mm.
stuff like that, would you want them to get transparent?
Mm.
I mean, in an ideal situation, in an ideal world, obviously
mm.
I would, right?
Mm.
So I would, if I vote for you, I want to know where the infrastructure fund is going.
Okay.
But realistically, I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. But I think in the future,
mm-hmm.
there is going to be there's going to be like decentralized governments where everything's on the public blockchain,
mm-hmm.
right? And I know for a fact that my 50 rupees or 100 rupees or $10 or $20 is
mm-hmm.
going into these allocations.
Okay, good. So, I mean, because we have so limited time, we'll have this conversation later. But there's several more things that you got to know. I mean, all money is based on scarcity, like we discussed.
Yeah.
And so even blockchain
mm-hmm.
And its currency, right?
Bitcoin
you want to call it, or Ethereum. They're also based on scarcity, and apparently the scarcity is energy.
Energy.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you want to explain why?
Sure. So I think
is that how the value is determined in the Bitcoin world or
yes.
the Ethereum world?
See, there are two things that need to be two conditions
mm-hmm.
that need to be met for something to be called a currency.
Okay.
A, it should be hard to obtain.
Okay.
The word you use, scarcity,
yes.
right?
Yeah.
And second thing is that particular object should have no value by itself.
Right.
The reason you can't have apples as
mm-hmm.
a system of currency
mm-hmm.
is because you can eat and consume an apple.
Right.
By itself, the apple is useful.
Okay.
Whereas with gold, by itself, gold is not very useful in most cases.
Mm-hmm.
A rupee, if everyone decides a rupee is useless, the rupee
mm-hmm.
is actually useless. You can't eat
right.
a rupee, you can't live under
right.
a rupee.
Yeah, it's just fictional.
It's a fictional thing, right?
Mm.
So you need these two things.
Right.
Now, what you also need is you need to introduce that scarcity.
Mm.
Right? So the blockchain system is actually, or rather Bitcoin, is actually a unit of currency.
Right.
Of electricity.
Okay.
Right.
Unit of electricity, I guess.
Every Bitcoin that's produced,
right.
remember, you're adding a new thing to the Google Doc, right? And that
right.
takes some computing power.
Okay. And he's using Google Doc as an example. So, and the unit of electricity is because Bitcoin is mined by powerful computers.
Yes.
So on. Yeah, okay.
You want to explain why it's hard to mine?
Quickly.
Why
yeah.
Okay. So, when it started back in 2008, so
mm-hmm.
what happened was to actually mine one block of Bitcoin,
mm-hmm.
It was very simple, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think the first block gave out around 50 Bitcoins as
mm-hmm.
a token.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened was there was a mathematical problem that the computer needs to solve.
Mm-hmm.
So initially people started off with their CPU,
mm-hmm.
then it went on to GPU,
mm-hmm.
okay, and then it went on to higher methods of hardware that was required.
Agreed.
And today you literally need a mining farm,
mm-hmm.
which is basically based out of China right now.
Mm-hmm.
So there are mining farms that are actually mining day in, day out, 24/7 to actually mine one Bitcoin, right? I mean, it's become that hard. And going forward, the mathematical transaction keeps getting more complicated. The hash
right.
keeps getting encrypted even more.
Right.
And it's extremely hard to solve the problem.
Right.
So the difficulty part of it increases your energy output, right? Which
okay.
you have to do. So as we move ahead, until and unless the quantum computer comes into play.
And therefore the value is rising.
Yes, therefore
okay.
the value is rising because the cost of acquiring one Bitcoin is extremely expensive right now.
Okay. You know, you guys are both 25-year-olds doing something wonderful with a 40-year outlook saying that the world will eventually move to these forms of transactions.
Yes.
Right? And you're a fan of Ethereum
yeah.
Versus Bitcoin, which I'll get into. Why bet on this? I mean, say I've had this conversation with you in the past. If you're exchanging milk, I'm a buyer of milk, consumer, and I come to both of you.
Yeah.
I mean, I might buy what the cheapest rate is. So how will the system there regulate the supply of money or value? Because I pay you something and I get something in return.
Yeah.
It's a fundamental trade question,
okay.
Which banks have controlled the value over, banks and governments. You're saying that will change.
Yes.
Is that what you think will happen in 10 years?
Yes. So, if I can go a little into the future, right, depending on what we're doing right now. So, today, if you look at any product or any commodity, right, the selling price is derived by your cost of raw materials, etc., etc., and you derive a selling price. But there are also some companies that actually put a premium onto their selling price.
The margin, yes.
The margin, yes. So, like, for example, Apple, right? But you do not know the exact cost of what an Apple costs today. But you're still willing to pay the premium.
Yeah. Yeah.
What happens...
Based on market forces.
Based on the market
yeah,
demand, supply metrics and stuff like that. What happens tomorrow when everyone's on the blockchain, everyone's trading in one single currency, be it Bitcoin, be it Ethereum, be it something called as a unified token or a universal token.
Okay.
Everyone's trading universal tokens, right? And the whole world is trading that. And now you have data from the entire world saying milk in India is 2 rupees, milk in maybe Japan is 5 rupees, and milk in some other country is something else, right? What the... You need artificial intelligence over here, right? And what you can do with this kind of data is you can actually determine the exact true value prices
of milk globally.
Milk globally.
And then,
you can categorize it in developing, emerging, you know, different kind of situations.
Because the meeting points of trade have changed, right? So where all can you obtain milk right now?
Yeah.
Milkman?
Milkman.
You go to a store, you can order it through Amazon.
Or factory.
Or go directly to the factory.
Direct
right? Manufacture. But this is not easy. But because everything is going online, you can see every single seller's selling price, buying price. You can see everything on the internet. So what's going to happen is eventually people are going to realize, listen, milk in India, they keep saying it's 10 rupees, but actually it's 4.5 rupees from this other town. I might as well order it online.
So amazing. This is like you're aggregating so much of data and eventually you'll build an AI tool to make sense of the value. And you're saying banks will also get into doing this in the future?
Yes,
I think they have to.
They have to?
They have to. So, I have an outlook on this. So, basically, if you look at the banks right now, it's kind of like an existential crisis that they're going through right now. Bitcoin and the different kind of cryptocurrencies and the blockchain is here to stay, right? For the near future, at least for the next 10 to 20 years. Because if tomorrow, say, 5 countries ban Bitcoin, that is always going to be a country which says, okay, I'm okay for Bitcoin, like Japan and Estonia, right? And if that's there, your demand and value is still there. So, you know, people start trading it.
Right.
So tomorrow, in my opinion, just like how we have a DMAT account right now, I think tomorrow there'll be a crypto CMAT account, which is going to, and I can actually go to HDFC Bank tomorrow and buy Ethereum and Bitcoin. Because, you know, the government just wants to regulate this, right? They want to know how much Bitcoin I have, how much Ethereum you have.
Okay.
So if I'm doing it through a CMAT account with my KYC, Aadhaar card linked, everything.
So funnily enough, I mean, the AI piece will decide inflation, deflation.
Yes.
But it's not going to end poverty, by the way. I don't think about that. So, but would you allow, I mean, you're aggregating data. Where are you going to get all this data from? Trade data, you know, international markets data.
It's all on that Google Docs.
It's like you're going to...
It's
all
public knowledge for everyone.
So you're going to just pull that and integrate it.
See, today, if I knew your blockchain address, I can tell you every transaction you've ever made on the blockchain in your life.
Okay.
Because I know this person has transacted with this person, and this person has transacted with this person, this person has transacted with this person. One of the classic examples is politics, right? I win an election, and the government has to give me, say, 5,000 crores. And I claim during my election that out of this 5,000 crores, 2,000 crores has to go for land work.
Correct.
Right? And in today's world, like, out of the 2,000 crores, if I take 2 crores, how will you know?
Right.
Right? But on the blockchain, I know exactly where you put each crore.
Okay.
This is the politician's address. 5,000 crores went here. 2,000 crores went here. Who is this person? I click a button, I can get that entire company's profile.
Okay.
Everything's transparent.
Interesting world, man. I mean, probably 30 seconds each on what is Ethereum, what is blockchain. And you guys are a fan of Ethereum. Why?
Yeah. So, the reason I like Ethereum is because it has an actual use case which can be used in the future, right?
Yeah.
So, Ethereum is basically programmable smart contracts where it self-executes different functions that you can put onto the blockchain.
Yeah.
So, Bitcoin and the blockchain technology is just a value of currency, right?
Yeah.
But in smart contracts, I can actually say, like, if one file comes to me, that file has to be automatically split to 5 people, right? Which cannot be done on the Bitcoin.
All right.
So, in that politics example, 5,000 crores comes in. With smart contracts, I can just...
This is Ethereum.
Smart. I can have a small page there that says, the minute 5,000, and this is code you have to write, right? The minute 5,000 crores is wired here, 2,000 crores immediately wired to this particular real estate company who's going to do your infrastructure work. Automatic. The person doesn't even have access to the bank account to be able to make this transaction.
Okay.
It just happens on its own.
Okay.
And the cool thing about smart contracts is they're publicly visible. So I can see the code. I can see, okay, this is, and there are ways to read smart contracts even for lay people, right? Okay, you know, out of the 5,000 rupees, he's 5,000 crores, he's saying 2,000 crores will go here, 2,000 crores will go here, 2,000 crores will go here.
Okay.
And he can't actually take any money out of this. None of the money is hitting his bank account. His bank account, 8,000 rupees is hitting, or how much ever the account.
Very interesting. So this is how the smart contract in the Ethereum world works, but it is still not Bitcoin. Can I make 2,000 crores in Bitcoin? And then, you know, is there a value there?
Yes. So if you have 2,000 crores in Bitcoin, you can convert it into Ethereum. Once you enter the crypto world, you can convert any coin from any other to any other coin.
As long as there's an exchange.
In the market right now, there are 2,000 coins.
Why are you fans of Ethereum again? Just because of smart contracts?
Yes,
that's it.
That's it.
Huh?
That is so powerful.
Is Bitcoin in a smart contract?
No. Ethereum was built with the core idea of making a smart contract, and you can literally do any kind of transaction automatically. And it's not currency, right? Tomorrow, if you upload KYC documents on the Ethereum blockchain, I can automatically say, as soon as you apply your KYC documents online, send it to HDFC, access everyone, and everyone gets a copy of your KYC documents.
Okay.
So it's not only currency. It's actually any kind of contract, any kind of data that goes onto the blockchain, publicly visible, automatically split to whoever you want.
And you guys are doing an ICO. Let's get into that ICO thing quickly. You said you're raising something through an ICO. Yeah. What is an ICO? I've heard of IPOs, but what is an ICO?
So ICOs are basically called an initial coin offering, right? Which is very similar to what an IPO is, initial public offering.
Uh-huh.
And in an IPO, you give stocks to people.
Okay.
In an ICO, you give coins to people, right?
Okay.
In an IPO, you have a DRHP and a red herring perspectives which
Correct.
People see.
Correct.
In an ICO,
Correct.
You have a white paper which people see.
And who publishes it?
The team.
The team.
Okay.
The team that wants to do the ICO.
So the white paper has to have a technical audit, has to have a legal audit, so that you're not doing anything wrong in that. And the crowd, which is so basically a crowdfunding platform, right? So people come onto this ICO, come onto your ICO page, look at your white paper, look at your team. I mean, they verify us, right? I mean, is Shashank legit? Is Varun legit? And then we have a lot of videos showing, you know, that we're doing this, we're doing that. So it proves our legitimacy.
Okay.
And then the user gets convinced that, okay, I believe Enkidu is a good project and I'm going to invest in Ethereum.
Okay.
Or in Bitcoin,
okay.
or in whatever currency I take tomorrow,
right?
Instead of fiat, it's all these different types.
Huh.
So it's basically an IPO itself, but instead of stocks, I'm giving them.
And you've got 40 million in commits, you said, right, or more?
No.
So we're raising
about 30 million.
We're raising around 30 million right now.
You're raising money of 30 million.
We're raising around 30
million.
So here, your cap table or your equity table is not touched.
Okay.
Right? Because in a private equity or a VC funding, your equity table is touched, right? Here, you don't touch your shareholding.
You want to explain that quickly? See, guys, they're saying that when you go through this world of raising money, the ICO world, your equity does not get touched.
Not
Why
so?
So, I'll take this, right? Very simple. You want to invest in a company. You put, say, 5 lakhs into a company and you tell them you do whatever you want.
And I take some percent.
25%. When will you get a return on that 25%?
Maybe 5 years.
What, under what condition? When the company sells itself,
exactly.
Or when the company goes ICO?
Yes.
IPO. You have to wait some number of years.
Correct.
The advantage of an ICO is you don't have to wait that period.
Okay.
You invest in this company that you think will do
so
well.
So am I investing in Bitcoin again or Ethereum or is money?
You're putting money into a particular ICO and you're getting their tokens in return.
Okay.
So the ICO says, okay, I have X number of tokens and I'm going to give each person this much.
Okay.
If they commit, you know, say $1,000.
Okay. What is a token?
Right, a token is just it's a unit of currency of that particular system.
Okay.
Right, so I give you one in our system. It's called ENK.
Okay.
I give you one ENK, and one ENK is worth zero.
ENK?
That's
Enkidu
the Enkidu
token.
Enkidu.
So it's always three to four letters.
So I put in money, I get a token.
Yes, you get a token,
and that's a value that I can sell anywhere in the Bitcoin or the Ethereum.
I'll explain how that works right in
Please.
A minute. So compared to private equity, you come to an exchange.
Okay.
You have these Enkidu, and you can go and you can. Eventually, at some point, if we get on an exchange, you can hit that. You can just put your Enkidu there, and somebody can come in and they can say, okay, you know, I'm willing to buy that Enkidu for say $1,000 or $1,200.
Right.
And that's when you make your money back. You
and
get
where
your
do I sell
exit.
And what platform do I sell it to you guys?
There are exchanges.
So how we have NSE,
Ethereum
BSC.
Exchanges.
Yeah, we have NSE, BSE, and the IP.
Are they legal?
Yes, they're legal.
Yes, they are. I mean,
you're sure, because
yes,
I saw a lot of my friends in the. Bitcoin world to get pulled up by tax authorities.
No, that's because they were hiding it, right? I mean, if you actually remove Bitcoin into your bank account and you actually go and pay your taxes, there's nothing wrong with that.
Okay.
The only weird thing why people are regulating it, the fear here is when I put in, say, 1 lakh into the market and within a month I remove, say, 1 crore.
Okay.
That raises questions, right? Because how can you make 1 crore?
Yeah, that's like speculation.
That's speculation, and that's when they come and, you know, come onto you and put an IT raid and be like, how did you get 1 crore from 1 lakh? Did you get some external source of funding or something like that? But if you're legitimate, right, you're putting in 5 lakhs and making, say, 15 lakhs, and you're showing it to the government and paying the taxes, and they're regulating this with your KYC. So if you look at the exchanges in India as well, right, so they all have KYC, right? You have to give your PAN card, Aadhaar card.
So you are legit.
Legit.
People can invest with, people can invest with you today.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes. You can just go to our website, go put in X amount of money, take X amount of tokens back, and tomorrow, under the condition that we get on an exchange, they can go and exchange it back for real money.
Okay, and by the way, you're going to invest with them only on based on the company's performance. And that's out there.
So that's how we perform on
future. And that's out there, right? Like the past history of the founders, the things we've done in the past, why we have experience to do this, and the product itself. So we have a live kind of alpha version. So at some point, the company performs. It in most cases, like, the coin will perform, right? And in this particular case, you're gambling, right? You don't know if the coin will go up or it'll go down.
Speculation.
In which case?
It's speculation.
It's not you when they bet with you.
Yeah, when they bet with when they bet with us. Just like when you're betting in a new company, right?
It's like shares, right? You
it's
qualify.
Like
because people might get confused that they're going to be gambling. It's like they're investing.
They're investing.
And they're investing
the risk,
on a
and investing
future
comes
value.
With risks. Yes, and investing comes with risks.
Okay.
So
I think gambling is a cuss word. We should use it. So yeah, good. So that's the crux of it.
Yeah.
You're going after what kind of industries? I realize that government is going to be big for you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You're also going to go after other industries? To build contracts or
economy.
So it's very simple, right? We want to give freelancers another way to make money.
So I'm a writer. I want to go write for you, for example, or for somebody like Aaron, our great social media consultant, right? So tell me, I mean, if he has to pay me for my work, how will that work?
Sure. So right now you can go to an Upwork or any freelancing platform. You say, okay, 1 hour of my time is worth $10 or worth 100 rupees. And every hour, Aaron gives you 100 rupees for some written material that you put in. But in this system, you say that, okay, you know, you want to sell a book online.
Correct.
I will write the first 10 pages of the book, or I'll keep writing pages of the book. And I don't want any money up front. When your book starts making sales, you give me royalties.
Sales outside?
Yeah, outside. Yeah, whenever the book starts selling,
even online, if people start
wherever.
So I get tokens again, Enkidu tokens.
No. In this case, you actually make royalties of the book.
Right, correct.
So basically, we are changing the world from you go and work.
So I put the book in your platform.
Yes.
And he reviews it, and he's selling it for me.
Yeah.
Or he's distributing it for me.
Yeah.
Sure.
So I get paid royalties in the form of proper cash or Ethereum tokens?
Proper cash.
How
think
does that happen?
So think about Aaron for a second, right?
Uh-huh.
He makes 100 rupees on a book.
Right.
Maybe his contract with you was like, okay, you write for me, you write the book for me, and I will give you 5% of any money I make.
Right.
And that is exactly what Enkidu does. You can talk to other people and tell them, look, I don't have money to pay you upfront, but if you're willing to take the risk with me, we're trying to breed a new age of entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, that is possible with actual companies.
So it's a smart contract between him and...
Yes, it's a smart contract. So every time a payment comes to Aaron's payment gateway, you get...
And you'll be the
5%.
Third party that verifies it.
Yes, we'll be the third party that verifies it.
The biggest problem here is you trusting Aaron, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what if he sells the
if
book...
If I've not met him at all.
Yeah, and if he doesn't give you the 10 rupees or 5 rupees...
Mm-hmm.
So, but this is because we're in the same room, you know Aaron, it's all fine, it's all cool, right? What if you're doing it with someone in UK or USA,
right?
Or with five people...
The gig economy is everywhere.
Yeah,
so I can be gigging in the US from in Bangalore.
Yes,
yep.
So as soon as
I may make a piece of music here, but I might sell it in the US.
Somewhere else, with another distributor in the US and one guy in Japan as well.
But historically, that's always been done for money. Today, we're allowing you to take a risk and be an entrepreneur.
Okay.
Everybody, however small your skill is, you don't need to amass a lot of money and raise funding and run a company. You can just say, look, I have this particular skill. I'm willing to give it away. I like your project. I want 5% in your project. Any sale you make, I want 5%.
That's what Aaron gets, 5%.
Yes.
And what isn't it for you?
What do you guys get?
We take a transaction fee. So in today's...
And the basic underlying theme is Ethereum. We are all operating on
Ethereum
here, right?
Yes.
So when you take a cut, it's in Ethereum tokens?
It's in ENK tokens itself.
Okay.
So Ethereum has this option where you can put apps onto their platform.
Mm-hmm.
So they're called decentralized apps.
So as a person who wants to do business on your platform, I don't have to worry about all this, right?
You don't even need to know the underlying
technology. As long as I get my value.
You'll get your
money. See, on the platform...
Let's call it money now, but value later.
Yes, you get your value.
Yeah.
Value is the right word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But here's how it works, right? You don't even need to know that the platform is powered by blockchain. Just like how you don't know what happens in under Paytm's hood, right?
Right.
You come to our platform, you say, Aaron...
But still, that's a bank platform. That's not...
Yes, I mean,
right?
I'm just saying, what happens under the hood is complete... You don't know what happens under the hood, right? So I'm drawing a parallel there and saying that you just need to tell Aaron, look, 50-50, Aaron.
Mm.
Whatever sale you make, 50-50.
Right.
That's it. You just set 50 to under his name and 50 under our name on our Enkidu app.
Okay.
And that's it. You press enter. And now Aaron, all he has to do is take the payment gateway from the app, put it on his website,
And every time a payment comes in, you get 50%.
Wow.
You don't have to
do the back end on the blockchain, right? So tomorrow, if you want to check what transactions has happened and how much he's sold,
or what
that
other transactions he's done with other people,
yes,
like
you can go to that blockchain and just look at everything what Aaron's done for the last 1 year, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years.
It's like the internet, right? Like Amazon is what? It's commerce, but it's e-commerce because it happens on the internet.
Wow.
We are companies, but it's B companies because we're on the blockchain.
Yeah.
All I can say, it's a brave new world.
Huh? Getting ready
for it. So yeah, and AI and blockchain, and you guys are going to aggregate all that data,
yeah,
where decisions are going to be made so-called in transparency, right?
Yes.
So hopefully it becomes a transparent world. We don't know that, but it is a brave new world for sure. And Varun and Shashank are going to lead it. If you guys want to read about them, go to enkidu.com.
.io.
Enkidu.io.
You
want to spell it again?
We'll do it together.
Yeah, you can. You want to quickly?
We'll do it on yesterday.
ENKIDU.IO.
Yeah, there's a lot of meat in that. You got to watch this interview again and again to understand what blockchain is. I got it. So talk to you guys later next week with another stellar startup. Thanks for being on YourStory.com. Check us out again. Bye.